to Linden Library tonight for our show. We appreciate you being here. Before I begin, I want to welcome Bob Sadowski, who's on our Board of Trustees for the library. Thank you. Hi, Bob. Before we start, let me tell you about some programs that are upcoming. We're starting with a book to film series, which will be the second Saturday of every month. So this Saturday at 1 o'clock, we're starting with The Glass Castle. We also have the books downstairs. On May 23rd, Wednesday night at 7 p.m., the Linden High School musical troupe will be here. So we ask that you come and support them as well. On June 9th, we will have, thanks to one of our clerks for picking out the program for us, Ken Leland will be here with his guitars. He'll be playing music from the movies that you didn't know were popular. You didn't know where they came from. For those of you that don't know, we do movies on a regular basis, usually on Wednesdays and Fridays around 1 o'clock. There's a movie list in the back along with all of these programs. And also, we're doing a fundraiser for the Linden Library's 90th anniversary. We have t-shirts for sale. They're $15 for size small through 1X, $17 for size 2 and 3X. The shirts are here, so they're available anytime. Can you hold that for me, please? Thank you. Tonight's program is sponsored by Kowalski Funeral Home, located on Roselle Street. Funeral Director Teresa Kowalski, along with Leonard Lee Funeral Home, located on Blanky Street. Proprietor is Bob Ayers, and Funeral Director is Vincent Vidalis, along with the Friends of the Linden Library, who is a 501(c) nonprofit organization. Our sole purpose is to fundraise and support the Linden Library. And for those of you that didn't know, this is our 90th anniversary. We became a tax-supported entity on January 1st, 1928. Our first location was located on Luckin's Place, currently known as the Moose Lodge. Our second location was then on Wood Avenue on the Main Street at what is now known as Pho Minh's Vietnamese Restaurant. And then we moved here in 1939. Of course, over the years, we've had several branches and we've had to close them and we're here. So we're not going anywhere. This building was open eight years ago, the new building, all right? So tonight I'd like to introduce to you Joe Gilligan. He's going to give you a musical history of the 50s. It's a live musical story on how the 1950s musical trends would evolve from big band to pop to rock and roll. Joey will take you on a journey through the era they called the Fabulous 50s, way before my time, and now in 10 short years, how radio stations would go from playing Sinatra to airing the musical likes of teenagers across the entire country, and the new music called rock and roll. Along with the invention called TV, the whole country would see a young man they would simply call Elvis, and hear new music that would change the way we would listen to music forever. Joey G has been singing professionally since the age of 13 and opened for Broadway stars Andrea McArdle, which was Annie on Broadway, Paul Williams, and many of the top acts of the 50s, among them Bobby Rydell, The Drifters, The Earls, and so many more. So sit back and relax and listen to Joey.
Thank you, Dawn. Thank you. And welcome to the musical history of the 50s. You know, the 50s started off with big band, went to what they call pop and then to rock and roll. It started off with radio, listening to radio, and then finishing up watching TV. How many people remember their first TV? Oh, yeah. Mine was a Philco. You remember that 9-inch television? Huh? What other kind did you have out there?
Dumont.
Dumont was big. RCA, right? Zenith was there, Admiral. It was a whole bunch, Emerson, there was a whole bunch of different televisions. But mine was a Philco, but it wasn't a 9-inch Philco, because my father heard a rumor that Philco was going to come out with a big screen television set. And he wasn't going to buy a television set until that big screen came out. So we're the last guys in the neighborhood to get a TV, because my father sit there waiting and waiting. And finally, my father was right. Philco came out with a 12-inch television set. And my father brought it home and put it right smack dab in the middle of the parlor. Not the living room, not the great room. In Jersey City, we call it the parlor. And there it sat right next to my mother's Italian provincial furniture. You know the furniture with the plastic on it? You couldn't sit on it in wintertime, it's too cold. And your ass stuck to it in the summertime. Remember that? And every night after supper, we called it supper. I don't know where the hell dinner came from. I never heard dinner before. We called it supper. You go home and check your Bible, see if there's a last dinner in there. Supper. Every night after supper, we went to the parlor to watch our favorite television show. And my mother's favorite television show was Arthur Garfrey's show. And he would have all these guests. Oh, he'd be great. Well, one day he had a real big guest on. His name was Dean Martin. Remember Dean Martin? So let me tell you a little bit about Dean Martin. My name is Dino Paul Crosetti, and I was born in Steubenville, Ohio. My mother and father only spoke Italian in the house. So when I grew up, went to school, I spoke broken English. And all the guys would make fun of me. I got in a lot of fights, and I learned how to fight. Let me tell you, I really learned how to fight. By the time I was 15, I learned a very valuable lesson. I was smarter than all the teachers in the school. So why should I stay in school? So I quit. Even my mother went to school one day and even told my mother, we can't teach this kid anything. That's how smart I was. That was a joke, by the way. So a year later, I started my boxing career because I knew I could fight. And I like to say I won all but 11 of my 12 bouts. I won one fight. So now I know I'm not going to be a fighter. So I took a job in an illegal casino stocking shelves, and I used to sing in the back room. I would sing as the band was playing up front. You know, one day the manager heard me and says, you know what, why don't you sing up in front with the band? And there was an agent in the audience and he liked me. He signed me to a contract. I started singing all these little clubs in Ohio. But one day his best singer got sick and he sent me to Atlantic City to take his place. That's where I meet this comedian from Newark, New Jersey. You know who I'm talking about?
Jerry Lewis.
Now we had separate acts, but on the third night, Jerry came dressed up as a busboy and we started our comedy act right there. And you know, we were doing great, but when we split up, not so good. Not for me. He was doing great, not me. But I got a little part in the movie with Frank Sinatra. He took me under his wing. And I always asked him, Frank, you started my career. You started my second career. I really appreciate it. Why me? He says, you know why, Dino? I'll tell you why. Because everybody loves somebody sometimes. So you want to sing along with me? All together. Everybody loves somebody sometimes. Everybody falls in love somehow. Something in your kiss just told me my sometime is now. Come on, sing along. There's no telling where love may appear. Something in my heart keeps saying, my someplace is here. Let me hold your hand a minute. If I had you in my shower, I'd ring every girl and child. Every hour, every boy would find what I found in your arms. Come on, sing it. Come on, you don't get any complaints in the shower. Sing. And although my dreams are over, your love made a well. Everybody loves somebody sometimes. Pokemon. Now, I'm what they call men's and men's. That means I'm half Irish, I'm half Italian. And my mother, well, she loved Dean Martin. And she loved pizza pie. So if you like to sing along, got a pizza parlor here in Linden, New Jersey. Yeah. And sing along with me. Ready? Here we go. Come on. When the moon hits your eye.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie.
That's amore. When the world seems to shine.
When the world seems to shine like you had too much wine.
That's amore. Bells are ringing.
Bells are ringing, ding-a-ling-a-ling, ding-a-ling-a-ling, and you sing Vida Bella. Hearts will sway, di-di-di-di-di-di-di-di-di-di, like a guitar in town.
When the stars that make you drool,
when the stars make you drool, just like Basta Azul,
that's amore.
When you dance down the street with a cloud at your feet,
you're in love.
When you walk in a dream, but you know you're not dreaming, signore.
All to that.
Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli,
that's amore. Your turn. Come on, everybody sing. Bells are ringing.
And you sing Vida Bella. Hearts will sway, dippy dippy day, dippy dippy day, like a guitar in town.
Lucky fella. Come on. When the stars make you drool.
You're in love.
When you walk in a dream,
but you know you're not dreaming, Señor. Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's some more.
Some more. Get you singing here a little bit. You're allowed to clap. Don't worry. Dawn, I know we're in the library, but they can be loud, can't they?
You can be noisy.
Okay, you can be noisy. You won't lose your library card. Don't worry. You know, I just got back from Florida. Well, I spent March down in Florida. I had a couple shows in Villages. You know what? You ever hear of the Villages? So I did a couple shows down in the Villages, and me and my wife, we missed all those four storms over there. You had the four, every Wednesday you had a storm. So when I get down to Florida, I said, where the hell is everybody? And there's nobody around. They're all golfing. Everybody's golfing. You know, everybody's out there golfing. So I said, you know what? I played baseball all my life. My two sons played professional baseball. I've been baseball all my life. I can hit a ball that's sitting there doing nothing. I mean, it's just sitting on a tee, right? So I what I did was I rented a golf cart and I rented some clubs and I got onto the first green and I hit a shot, a beautiful shot. If you know baseball, it was right down the right field line. It was like a stand-up double. It was a great shot. But in golf, you have to hit them straight. So now I gotta get in my golf cart and I gotta go chase the ball. So now these golf carts are a lot faster than you think they are. You know, these things can really fly. So I hit like a ridge. And I flipped the golf cart right over on top of me. And I'm laying there, I hit my head, I scraped my face, and I'm looking, I see a little bit of light. So I went to the light, and I crawled out, and as I'm crawling out, I noticed there was a woman coming across. She was coming from one of those villas. You know they have those villas right near the golf cart? And she comes over, And she runs over, and I'm just about out now, and she says, "Are you okay?" And I said, "Well, I hit my head, and I got scraped up here a little bit." That's when I noticed that she was wearing one of those robes you could practically see through, you know? So I said, "Oh, boy, what am I going to do here?" She says, "Why don't you come up to my villa?" And she says, "I'll clean you up." And I says, "No, I don't think so. I don't think my wife would like that." But you know what? I'm a nice guy, so I went up to the villa with her. So I got up to the door, she opens the front door for me, and she says, "Come on in." I says, "No, you know, I think I better get going. I don't think my wife would like that." She says, "No, come on in, I'll clean you up." So she sat me on the couch, and she cleaned me up. And then she says, "Why don't you lay down here a little bit? You might feel better when you wake up." And I says, no, I gotta get going. I don't think my wife would like that. But I did, I laid there for about 2 hours. And I got up a couple hours later, and she's standing there with 2 glasses of scotch in her hand, and I'm saying, "Oh, boy." She said, "Let's have a glass of scotch together, you'll feel." I said, "No, I don't think so. I don't think my wife would like that." but I'm a nice guy, so I had a couple scotches with her, and, you know, we're talking, and she was very nice, and then all of a sudden, she took me by my hand, and she says, "Come on, let's have a little fun. Let's go to the bedroom." And I says, "No, I don't think so. I don't think my wife would like that." She says, "Where is your wife anyway?" And I said, "I think she's still under the golf cart." That's a true story. You like that one? My wife didn't like it. Well, this next guy used to be a barber. Before he was a singer, he was a barber. Anybody got an idea who that would be?
Huh?
Right, this guy's right. Perry Como. Perry Como. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name's Perino Ronald Cuomo. And I was born in Cannonsburg, Pennsylvania, one of 13 children, and the first one to be born here in the United States. Now, in those days, we had no welfare, we had no food stamps, you had to earn everything. So I went down to the barbershop when I was 10 years old, and I says, "I could clean this barbershop out if you pay me." And he says, "Okay, I'll give you 50 cents a week." So you know what? That helped. It helped my family. So here I am. By the time I was 12 years old, after practicing on my brother and my father's hair, they gave me my own barber's chair. I used to have to step on a box just to cut hair. At 15 years old, my father had a very bad heart attack and he couldn't work in the mill anymore, so we all had to step it up, the whole family. Now, I was cutting hair for a guy. He says, "You know what, I got on the other side of Cannonsburg, I got a warehouse. Little spot over there would be great, really good for a barbershop. Would you like to open up a barbershop?" At 15 years old, I started my own business. And he called me the singing barber, because when I cut hair, I sang at the same time. Now, when I was 17, I went to a picnic and met the love of my life, Rosalie. And a few years later, we got married and we started a family. The barbershop was doing great, but one day an orchestra came to town. And their lead singer quit, and they asked me to come up and do a couple songs. And I did, and they liked me, and they said, "We're going to sign you to a contract, Perry. We're going to give you $35 a week if you come on the road with us." And I says, "You know, I'm making more than that at the barbershop, and I got the family." But Rosalie said, "Perry, this is what you wanted to do. You don't want to be a barber, you want to sing. Go ahead." So I went on the road for a number of years, but I missed my family, so I quit. I came back to Cannonsburg to open up my new barbershop, but just before I signed the lease, I got a friend of mine calls me up. He says, "Hey, I just wrote a radio show. I want you to be the host." And I says, I don't think so. I can't do it. I got the family, you know." Rosalie said, "Do it. Take the radio show." Well, it became the biggest radio show of the late 40s, early 50s. It was called the Chesterfield Hour. And it was so big that they gave me my own television show and 2 cardigan sweaters to wear. I like this lady. You come with me for the next show. So here I am. I'm a big television star now, and everything's going great. But just before our 65th anniversary, Rosalie suddenly passed away. And although I wanted to sing, I just didn't have it in my heart. They kept saying, "Perry, one more time, just come out one more." I said, "No, I can't. Without Rosalie, it's impossible." It's impossible. Tell the sun to leave the sky. It's just impossible. It's impossible. Ask a baby not to cry. It's just impossible. Can I hold you closer to me and not feel you going through me? Split the second that I never think of you. How impossible. Can the ocean keep from rushing to the shore? It's just impossible. If I had you, could I ever want for more? It's just impossible. And tomorrow, should you ask me for the world, somehow I'd get it. I'd sell my very soul and not regret it. For to live without your love is just impossible. Can the ocean keep from rushing to the shore? It's just impossible. If I had you, could I ever want for more? It's just impossible. And tomorrow, should you ask me for the world, somehow I'll get it. I'd sell my very soul and not regret it. For to live without your love is just impossible, impossible. Terry Como, the Baba. Thank you. Now this next guy, I was telling Brad, this next guy changed music forever. No one changed music more than this guy did, believe it or not. And maybe you don't even know, some of you might not know his name. His name was Johnny Ray. Anybody remember Johnny Ray?
Yes.
Well, Johnny Ray, let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name's John Ray. I was born on a farm in Oregon. My mother and father were dirt farmers and they had no money. I'm talking none. No money. So, you know, my dream in life, 9 years old, I wanted to go to Boy Scout camp. And we couldn't. We had no money, so they needed me to work the farm. Never went until I was 13. Somehow they saved up enough money, my parents. And when I get there, I'm the littlest, skinniest guy. And when you're the littlest, skinniest guy in Boy Scout camp, you're going to be the guy in the blanket. And the big guys used to throw you up and catch you on the way down. One day they missed. I don't know if it was on purpose. But I landed on a pile of straw, and a piece of straw went in my right ear. And it developed an infection. In fact, it got worse and worse every day. When I got home, I didn't tell my mother and father. We couldn't afford a doctor, so I lost almost all my hearing in my right ear. Now, being we were so poor, we went to church almost every day. That was our only entertainment, to go to church. And I joined the choir because I like to sing. But I noticed the choir was singing on one note, and I'm on a completely different note. Not even close. I'm in front of the music. I'm behind the music. So I developed a whole different style of singing. So different that when I grow up, no one would give me a contract. They used to say, no, he's in front of the music. He's all over. He'll never have a hit. He's all over the place. He lays on the ground, rips his clothes. What's with this guy? Because I just couldn't hear the music. I would concentrate so hard on the band that I forget there was an audience out there. But one guy believed in me. He says, I'm going to give you one shot, one song, Johnny. Columbia Records owes me a favor over there. It's a country and western song, but you can do it any way you want. I got these four guys we just hired last week. They're going to back you up. They call themselves the Four Lads. They'll back you up on the song and see how you do. Well, guess what? I fooled everybody. Because the song went to number one. I broke all the records, still today, 11 straight weeks at number one. Does anybody know what the name of that song was?
Cry.
It was called Cry.
Cry.
So I'm going to do it the way Johnny Ray would do it, okay? You Want me to do it the way Johnny Reed did?
Yes.
Johnny Ray and Cry.
If your sweetheart sends a letter of goodbye, it's no secret you'll feel better if you cry. When waking from a bad dream, don't you sometimes think it's real? But it's only false emotions that you feel. You know the words if your heart aches, right? If your heart aches seem to hang around too long, and your blues keep getting bluer with each song, we can be found behind a cloudy sky. So let your head down and go right on, baby, and cry. Hope the floor's clean. If your heartache seems to hang around, I have a hard time getting up. It's the Lipitor. You know, you get it in the joints, and it's no good if you don't Lipitor. With each song, well, now, remember, sunshine can be found behind a cloudy sky. Want to help me out? So let your head down and go right on, baby, and come on, guys, cry. Come on, I need your help, guys. Let's go. Sing along. All right, cry. Johnny Ray. Now, this next guy came along right in the middle 50s. Came along because they were looking for a guy that was complete opposite of Elvis Presley. They had to find somebody that was different than Elvis. Elvis was cornering the market with everything. They were looking for this guy who would be an all-American boy. And you know what? I grew up in Nashville, Tennessee. My name is Eugene Boone. They call me Pat Boone. And I hang around the studio all the time, waiting to get just a record contract. If I could only get a record contract, oh. But no one would give it to me. But that one guy came in, talent scout from Columbia Records, signed me to a contract. And I started singing songs like Tutti Frutti Over Rudy. Remember those kind of songs? And I'm selling records like crazy. I mean, I am selling records. The second most records in the 50s I sold. Elvis was first. I'm second. So here I am, one day in the studio. Right next to me in the studio, they're doing a song. It was slow. It's monotonous. It's a poem. But you know what? It's pretty. I want to sing it. They said, no, you can't do it. You're not allowed to do that. You're a rock and roll guy. I says, I'm selling records. You owe me. Give me that song. You know what? I recorded that song. In fact, it was on a day like today, and I recorded it. See if you know it. On a day like today, we pass the time away, riding home in the sand. How you laugh when I cry each time
the time. Take our love letters from the sand. You made a vow that you would ever be true, but somehow that vow meant nothing to you. Now my broken heart aches with every wave that breaks over love letters in the sand.
Can anybody whistle? Can you whistle? Who can whistle? There's a lady who can whistle. Whistle. Actually, Pat Boone whistled this whole party. Good, huh? You spit all over the microphone.
Broken heart ache with every wave that breaks over love letters in the sand.
All right. How about the guy whistling? That was good. Just gonna get a drink of water, okay? They say in Jersey City, water. You know, we just moved from our big home, 4,000 plus square feet on 9 acres, to a 55 and older community. It's like, you know, to an 1,800 square foot condo. It's beautiful. I mean, it's really nice. But my wife said, we're moving, we might as well get some new doctors, you know, because the doctor would be too far. So I said, okay. So I looked up on, there was a call, Ringwood area, and there was a doctor there, Mario Bacigalup. Mario was an Irish guy, so we went over to him, and I'm sitting right next to the examining room, and it's a little crowded, you know, and it was two old people, and he called in Harry. He says, Harry, come on in here, and Harry came in, and he says, Harry, hold, how old are you? He says, I'm 92. 92. You know what? Your blood pressure's good. He says, your heartbeat's pretty good. He says, you're doing okay. You know, everything, memory, yeah, everything's good. He says, okay. He says, send Millie in. So Millie comes in. He says, Millie, how old are you? She says, I'm 90. She says, I'm 95. He says, 95? You're even older than Harry. And you look great. I mean, blood pressure, everything else. And he says, but when I was talking to Harry, I asked him a couple of questions. I says, Harry, how's the memory? And Harry told me, he says, my memory's fine. Don't ask me again. So I'm not going to argue with Harry. So he says, but the prostate, Harry, you know, you got to go to the bathroom all the time. You know, I, you know, guys go to the bathroom. Right, guys? Middle of the night? You don't want to admit it? I go once a night. Anyway, Harry says, I only go once a night. I go once a night to the bathroom. I get there. I open the door. The good Lord turns the light on for me. I do what I have to do, and I come back to bed. He's okay. He says, Happy Millie. He says, I can't understand. I don't understand the memory. She says, oh, men's and men's. The memory's okay. But how about going to the bathroom? Well, you know, he just goes once a night. I says, all right, that's pretty good. You know, only once a night. He says, but what bothers me is when I ask him, he says, when he gets there, the good Lord turns a light on for him. He goes to the bathroom and comes back. She says, oh, no, please, don't tell me that. Don't tell me that he said that to you. And I said, why? Please, you know, don't tell me that. I said, well, I got to ask you the question, why? Why can't I tell you that? She says, Harry's peeing in the refrigerator. That's a true story. Anyway, you might have to cut that one out. This next guy actually was a great athlete. Before he became a singer, he was a phenomenal athlete. All-state in basketball, All-American in track. In fact, he was so good in track that San Francisco State University offered him a full scholarship if he became the high jumper. And he took that scholarship. Now, one day, Johnny Mathis went down to the mailbox, and there was two letters in there. One letter was an invitation to the Olympics. That's how good he was. The other letter, that was a contract from Columbia Records. Now, Johnny Mathis is no fool. Come on. Chances are he wouldn't have made the Olympic team. Got to do it over. Hang on. Johnny Mathis, chances are.
Chances are, cause I wear a silly ring. The moment you come into view, chances are you think that I'm in love with you. Just because my compulsion sort of slips the moment that your lips meet mine, chances are you think my heart your valentine. In the magic of moonlight, when I saw me close to you, chances are you believe the stars that fill the skies are in my eyes. Guess you feel you'll always be the one and only one for me. And if you think you could, well, chances are really good. Chances are you believe the stars that fill the skies. In my eyes, guess you feel you'll always be the one and only one for me. And if you think you could, well, chances are awfully good. The chance.
Johnny Mathis. Now, this next guy really needs no introduction. He was born in Tupelo, Mississippi, moved to Memphis where he became a truck driver, and then he recorded a song for his mother at this Sun Records, and they liked him so much they signed him to a contract. Anybody know who that guy would be?
Elvis.
Elvis Presley. Let me tell you a little bit of... I got to tell you the first time I ever did Elvis song. Just a kid, I was singing around the house. My mother, who's Italian, would say, Junior, you know, that's what they call me, Junior. Junior, pretty good singer. I said, you know, but you know, that doesn't mean anything, because my mother's Italian, and all Italian mothers tell their kids they can sing, whether they can or not. But one day, my four Italian aunts, my mother's sisters, came over the house, and they sat right on the couch, right in the pile. And my mother says, sing for your aunts. I said, Mom, I don't want to sing for your aunt. I don't want to sing for my aunts. Come on, Mom. She said, you sing for your aunts. I said, I'm not going to do it. She said, you want the wooden spoon? I said, I'll sing for my aunts. So I sang a song called The Tennessee Waltz. Remember that song? Yeah. And they must have liked me, because if Italian aunts like you, they come up and they pinch your cheek, you know? So they pinched my cheek. In fact, my Aunt Mimi, she was ambidextrous. She could do both cheeks at the same time. My cheeks hurt for like a week and a half. So now I know I can sing. Hey, if your Italian aunts tell you that you can sing, you can sing. So I formed a group. We're in the seventh grade. I formed a group called the Top Coats. And we put ourselves into the seventh and eighth grade contest, talent contest. And we didn't expect to win this contest. We just knew there was a lot of better people out there than us. And so we would practice every day, because every day up at Tommy Capek's house. He had a garage in the back of his house, and we practiced it every day. We didn't expect to win, but what we wanted to do was impress the eighth grade girls. There's a lot of cute girls in the eighth grade, let me tell you. So we're gonna impress these eighth grade girls. They won't dance with us, they won't talk with us. We're gonna impress them, we're gonna take them away from the eighth grade guys. So here we are practicing every day. Now one day, his big brother Frankie, he was in high school, he was like a senior, and he had his own band. This guy knew music better than Guy Lombardo, anybody. He knew music, and he said, "You guys are pretty good. We're doing a song called Just Walking in the Rain, Johnny Ray song." And he says, "You're pretty good." He says, "What happens if you win this contest? Do you have an encore?" And we said, "Well, what's an encore? We don't know what. What's an encore?" He says, "You gotta have another song. You can't do the same song. You gotta have another song." I said, "Well, Frankie, what do you think we gotta do?" He says, "Well, you wanna impress the eighth grade girls, right?" I said, "That's our goal. We want to impress the eighth grade girls." He says, "Do an Elvis song. Because you'll impress the eighth grade girls if you do an Elvis song." So guess what? We won the contest. And we had to do an encore. And we did this Elvis song. So I'm going to do this Elvis song for you a little bit, okay? So I hate to ask this, but I got to. Would you mind, not the guys, but the girls, would you mind being eighth grade girls for just a second? Okay. So if I kind of make a move, would you mind giving me a scream? Last show they were throwing some clothing at me. You don't have to do that. I won't say what it is because we're on camera. So here we go. We're going to do a little Elvis song for you, okay?
It is a library, remember that.
Here's Elvis. Treat me like a fool, treat me mean and cruel, but break my faithful heart, tear it all apart, but love me. Come on. I'll see you after the show. You were her goal, and darling, I'll be all so lonely. I'll be sad and blue, crying over you, dear only. Just to feel, can't help wiggling here. Your heart,
I want your heart
beating close to mine. Come on, ladies, ready? Come on, I got it. Be on. So lonely, begging on my knees. All I ask is please, please love me. I would beg and steal. I'm gonna be hurting tomorrow.
just
to feel. Your heart. Come on, I can catch. Beating close to mine. Where have you ever gone? Darling, I'll be home. So lonely. Begging on my love me. Oh, yeah, yeah. My wife doesn't come to any of my shows anymore. We've been married 52 years, me and my wife. 3.5 years of my life. I'm only kidding. Great wife, great wife. We had a great life. And we did very well in life, so I'm able to do this now. Now, I've got to tell you, when I was a kid, same age, 13, summertime. I don't know if the guys did this one, but when we were kids, we did. We ended up on in the ball field. We go up on the top of the bleachers, and we talk about, well, we talk about baseball, and we talk about girls. I mean, that's what you did when you're 13 years old. So one day, the older girls in the neighborhood, they came and sat on the bottom of the bleachers. And you know what? They had equipment our girls didn't have. So we wanted to look at them, and they started looking back. And we said, we got to get out of here, because we're embarrassed. So we start going down the bottom of the beaches, and one of the girls, still remember her name, Ellen Murphy. Ellen says, hey, Junior, remember they call me Junior, come on over here. He said, the girls think you're cute, still pretty cute, right? 74 years old, what do you think? So I'm still pretty cute. So they say, I'm only kidding. She says, we're gonna go to see Alan Freed, the rock and roll show tomorrow. You wanna go? And I says, oh, you kidding me? With a 17-year-old girl, I'm 13, yeah, I wanna go. She says, well, come on, we're gonna go. I said, well, you gotta ask my mother. So they went across the street, they asked my mother. They said, Aunt Jo, everybody in the neighborhood, I called everybody that was a neighbor, was an aunt. We didn't really have, they weren't aunts. I didn't even know who my aunts were. It was so many aunts. And they all came with one uncle, it seemed, you know? So here we are, they asked Aunt Jo, can I go? Can we take Junior? And she says, sure. So we hopped the bus, we hopped the train, and we got to the Brooklyn Paramount. 4,200 kids, that's what they held. Wow. We're up in the balcony, and out comes this guy. He says, my name is Alan Freed. I'm the guy that gave the name rock and roll. He's the guy that gave it the name. And he says, and I got great acts for you. I got 20 acts for you tonight. He says, and he names all the acts. Now, this one particular day, well, there was two acts that had really had the same song. They both had number one hits. The song was the same. The words were different. Background was pretty much the same. Today, it would never get away with it, but in those days, they both had number one hits. One group was from LA, they were from Los Angeles, they called themselves the Penguins, and they had a hit called Earth Angel. The other group, well, they were right from New York, they called themselves Little Anthony Imperials, and they had a hit called Tears on My Pillow. So, I'm gonna do them for you, but you like to sing along with me? I'm gonna get my voice back to 13, think I can get back to 13 years old? Here we go. Remember this?
You don't remember me, but I remember you. It was not so long ago, you broke my heart in two. Tears on my pillow, pain in my heart caused by start anew, I wouldn't hesitate. I'd gladly take you back and tempt the hand of fate. Tears are my pillow, pain in my heart caused by you. Love is not a gadget. Love is not a toy. Oh, when you find the one you love to fill your heart with joy. If we could start anew, I wouldn't hesitate. I'd gladly take you back and tempt the hand of fate. Tears are my pillow, pain in my heart caused by you.
just added a Y to it. That was it. Angel and Tears in My Pillow. Now, how about how many of them people remember their first teenage dance? Remember that first teenage dance? Where is it? It's in the school gymnasium. And the boys are on one side of the gym, and the girls are on the other side of the gym. Now, the DJ, he's smart. He says, I got to get these kids to dance. There's only one way of doing it. What do you think he's going to do? He's going to have a lady's choice. Because the girls will ask the boys, but the boys will never ask the girls. So he says, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, this next song is going to be a lady's choice. And as the girls cross the gym floor to ask that cute boy they met in English class to dance, the DJ plays the number one song of all time. There's a group from Bridgeport, Connecticut. They call the song themselves the Five Sounds. The song goes like this. Remember it? In the still of the night, I held you tight, for I love you so. Promise I'll never let you go. In the still of the night.
So before hold me again, dear, with all of your might, in the still of the night.
Still in the night. Bring back some memories, huh? Okay. Before I do this next song, I gotta tell you something. I'm a big history buff. I love history. Anywhere I go, anything I read, it's gotta be about history. And if you wanna read really true history, you gotta read the Bible. Because the Bible has more history in it than anywhere. In fact, I read the Bible like 10 times. I got so enthused that I tried to find things that didn't make it into the Bible. And I found a story. They must have ran out of paper or something in those days. This story actually didn't make it to the Bible. And you want me to tell it to you? Because you're not going to hear it at church, right? You're only going to hear it here, because I'm the only guy who knows about it. When it was 2,000 years ago, when Jesus was walking all through the desert, he had hundreds and hundreds of followers. And he came down to this little town called Bethlehem. You heard that town. As he's coming into town, you know they got those big billboards up there, you know? One billboard says, "Visit Finkelstein's Tailor Shop. Best robes in the Middle East." So Jesus looked at his robe and says, "You know what? This thing is really torn and tattered. I think I'll get a new robe." So he goes into Finkelstein and he says, "You think you can make me a new robe?" Finkelstein says, "Sure. When do you want the robe?" He says, "I need it this afternoon. I'm going back on the road again." Finkelstein says, "You come back this afternoon, I have a robe for you." So Jesus comes back in the afternoon, puts on a robe, beautiful. I think it was 50% rayon or something like that. It was no wrinkles. It was really a nice robe. And Jesus says, "I love this robe. What do I owe you for this robe?" Finkelstein says, "You owe me nothing." He says, "You're Jesus, right?" And Jesus says, "Yes." He says, "You owe me nothing, but do me this one favor." And Jesus says, "Sure, I'll do anything you want." He says, "When you go out and talk to all those people again, mention Finkelstein's Tailor Shop." So Jesus goes out. This time he's out there for 18 months. He comes back down to Bethlehem, walks in, and Finkelstein spots him. And he comes running out and says, "Jesus, I got to tell you something. I'm selling robes like crazy." He says, "We got to go into business together." Jesus says, "Yeah." He said, "Yeah, we can make a lot of money together." He said, "Well," Jesus says, "what will we call ourselves?" He says, "We're going to call ourselves Finkelsteins and Jesus." Jesus says, "I don't like that. I'm not crazy about that." He said, "Well, you're Jesus. You think of something." So now Jesus walks him back and forth. He's thinking and thinking. Finally, about a half hour later, he says, "I got it." And Finkelstein says, "What?" "Lord and Taylor." You didn't realize that story's 2,000 years old? That's a true story. That's a true story. Well, this next song, I got two more songs for you. This next song was written in 1942 by a young lady that was hoping that her husband would come home from the Second World War state. And she called it "Hurry Home to Me." Never made a big hit, even though Bing Crosby had it out. Dee Martin put it out. Peggy Lee put it out. Not a hit. But in 1952, a lady named Jo Stafford put it out. She changed the name to "You Belong to Me." Then a group from my hometown, about 10 years later, in Jersey City, they sang it. So I'm going to ask you to sing this song with me, okay? Especially the part that says, "You belong to me." You ready to do it? Okay, here we go. See the pyramids along the Nile. Watch the sunlight on a tropic island. Just remember, darling, all the while. Ready, come on. You can do better. See the marketplace in hope. Send me photographs and souvenirs. Just remember when a dream appears. Come on, louder. That's better. I'd be so alone without you. Maybe you'll be long since blue and blue. Fly the ocean in a silver plane. Watch the jungle when it's wet with rain. Just remember till you're home again. Now I'm gonna count to three. In Jersey City, we say tree. So you ready? One, two, three.
You belong to me.
All right, enjoy yourselves tonight. I want to thank Dawn. Dawn, thank you so much for having me. And we got one more song left. And I got to ask you a question, because I don't know if anybody's here my age, but you got to be somebody close to my age. But I get up every morning, and I walk up to the mirror, and I ask myself this question. What the hell happened? No, I didn't ask that question. I ask a question that's on your mind all the time. In fact, when I start saying it, you're going to finish it, and I know, then I'll know that you're thinking the same thing I'm thinking. And I'm thinking, why must I be
a teenager?
See that? See that? You're all asking that question, right? Get the acne, get that Clearasil out and clean those pimples up. We're going to do this song, so you ready to do it for me? Teenager in Love. Here we go. Dion and the Belmonts. Come on. Can I still dance? I can't do a split anymore. Each time we have a quarrel, it almost breaks my heart. For I am so afraid that we would have to part. Each night I ask the stars. Come on, yell it!
Why must I be a teenager?
You having a hard time remembering? I feel so happy. Next day I feel so sad. I guess I'm learning to take the good with the bad. Each night I ask the stars up above. I'm crying for nobody but you. I'll be a lonely one if you should see we're through. What if you want me cry? That won't be so hard to do. And if you should say goodbye, well, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Come on, yell it!
Say goodbye, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Last chance, come on.
Why must I be a teenager in love?
Say, why must I be a teenager?
I can't hear you.
Why must I be a teenager in love? Why must I be?
All right. Hope you had a good time. My name's Joey G, and I did have a gold record somewhere along the line. But I hope you enjoyed yourself. I want to thank Dawn for having me here tonight. We didn't have a big crowd, but we had a nice crowd, right? Tell your friends that I'll be back next year to do another show for you, and we're going to pack the place, right, Dawn? Tell your friends that I'm going to be back next year sometime. I got a new show called, what is it? Oh, The Birth of Rock and Roll. It's a good one, really good one. That's with the Platters and everybody, so I think you really like that one. And some of my buddies that I sang with years ago, like the Earls and the Belmonts, I've sang with all of them, the Duprees, all good guys. And it was a great music. It was great music. It was the start of something new, right? So I hope you enjoyed yourselves. If you belong to another organization, like the seniors, if you belong to the VFW, you belong to the Knights of Columbus, you belong to the JCCs. I know we're in Linden, New Jersey, so if anybody's getting out of jail early and you need some entertainment, come up and get one of our cards, okay? All right, God bless you. Thank you so much.